there are some things that you may have heard that are untrue, and I'm going to dispel those myths about guitar playing and guitar in general. Now, some of these things you may have already heard about or formed opinions on, so hopefully you agree with me. Otherwise, you're really not gonna like me. In all seriousness, I did do a lot of research on some of the more controversial points that I'll be making in this video. And of course, this is not necessarily an original idea, is it? There have been other YouTube personalities who have made lists about guitar myths, so I would encourage you to check their videos out as well. But I do have some unique perspectives, I think, that I can offer you. So without further ado, let's jump into 10 guitar myths that you believe. Myth number one, you need big hands to play the guitar. Steve Vai, huge hands. Jimi Hendrix, huge hands. Paul Gilbert, huge hands. Me, huge hands. Did I just put myself in the same sentence as Vai, Hendrix, and Gilbert? What an arrogant bastard. The truth is, hand size can be an advantage regarding certain situations where you have to reach across many different frets, but overall, no, you do not need big hands to be an amazing guitar player. And you also don't need skinny fingers versus fat fingers to be a dexterous and astronomically quick guitar player. The fact is, you will develop muscle memory in your fingers and hands, and they will go to the correct place that they are supposed to go without you even thinking about it. Your fingers are not too fat to do these things. Any hand can be trained to do any sort of movement regarding dexterity. Also, my fretting hand can actually stretch about an inch further than my picking hand, and that is because of flexibility that I built up over time. You can develop flexibility. It's like yoga for your hands. Anybody can do it. Your hands will become stronger. It's easy to blame issues when you're just starting out on guitar on small hands, but the fact is you're just not good at guitar yet, so keep practicing. Your hands will strengthen and become more dexterous, and you will be shredding in no time. Myth number two, more gain, heavier tone. No, that's wrong. In fact, for recording and live performance alike, you'll actually have a more punchy and defined and ultimately heavier sound if you dial back the gain a little bit. You'll also have a much more articulate picking attack that will reveal exactly what it is you're playing, forcing you to actually execute your parts well for them to sound good, which is a good thing because we want to be good guitar players, and you will be a great guitar player if you can play on a bit less of a gain setting. Think about AC/DC's guitar tone. Those songs were heavy as hell, and they did not need the gain dimed for them to achieve that heavy sound. That reminds me of another side myth to dispel. More gain does not equal more volume. Myth number three, skill is measured by how long you've been playing the guitar. This is maybe the question I've received most from non-guitar players or hobbyists. How long have you been playing the guitar? And here's the thing, if I told you that I've been playing guitar for 20 years, you would think that I'm better than the same version of myself who said I've been playing for 10 years. More means better, right? But what if I'd only played a couple times a month for an hour here and there over the span of 20 years versus every day for 45 minutes for 4 years? The truth is, I would be in a much better situation if I were in that latter situation. That's why I always respond to this question with, it's not how long you've been playing, it's how often you play. And also, not to sound like a snarky jerk, I'll tell them how long I've been playing. It's about 14 years at this point. Myth four, analog is better than digital. Ah, a nice tone snob myth, wherein the tone snob spends more time collecting and analyzing gear than actually practicing the guitar. I'm always wary of people who review gear and know everything about gear who can't actually play the guitar that well. It's like, how can you identify any tonal differences in gear when you're just playing the same five crappy blues licks over and over again? The thing is, the difference between an analog and a digital guitar effect is just that. A difference. There are different options for different musical situations. Some of my favorite guitar effects are in fact digital, and they sound amazing. Analog guitar pedals, especially older ones, are kind of more about the aesthetic that it offers the guitar player as opposed to the fact that the sound may or may not be able to be duplicated. They can. Myth number five, beginners should start with an acoustic guitar. Wrong. That's like starting to curl dumbbells with 40-pound weights instead of 10-pound weights. Look, guitar is hard enough because you have to strengthen muscles you've never used in your hands and develop coordination. you don't have to put an extra burden on yourself by starting with an acoustic guitar. By playing the electric guitar, it's gonna be a little bit easier on your hands, and that will allow for potential consistent little victories along your guitar playing journey in the beginning. If you don't do that, you're gonna have a bad time. And yes, if you become proficient on the acoustic first, then of course those skills will translate over to the electric guitar. But the myth that you have to start on acoustic guitar, false. Also, you don't have to start with a ukulele either. You wanna feel cool, don't you? I mean, ukulele, I'm not saying it's not cool, but it's not on electric guitar. Myth number six, I like this one. You'll lose all your feel and emotion in your guitar playing if you learn music theory. That's kind of like a car mechanic trying to fix a car with only a screwdriver and a hammer. They may be able to get the job done, but there's a limited amount of what they can actually accomplish. Music theory is a tool belt, and your musicianship is the car that you are working on. And those who tell you that music theory will negatively impact your guitar playing and creativity, well, those people don't know any music theory themselves because they're lazy, and they're justifying their laziness with lies. Put it this way, you're never smarter for not knowing something. Myth number seven, beginners should start with inexpensive guitars. This is sort of similar to the whole beginners should start with an acoustic guitar fallacy. You shouldn't start with an inexpensive guitar if you have the means to afford a higher end guitar. Not only will you be able to improve faster and enjoy playing the guitar more because it's a higher quality instrument, you'll be accountable for it. You'll have made an investment and you won't want to lose that financial contribution that you've made to your musicianship development. A cheap beginner guitar is much easier to just set in the corner, forget about it, cut your losses, and it's also going to be a little bit more difficult on your guitar playing and development because of the setup of the instrument. It's a little bit harder to maintain that. But I have to stress again, you do not need an expensive guitar to become an amazing guitar player. I can't stress that enough. But there's a reason a Les Paul costs more than some starter guitar from Target. It's a better guitar. Myth number eight, heavier gauge strings are harder to play than lighter gauge strings. Okay, kinda, but not really. If you start on thinner strings, sure, it's gonna be a little bit easier on your fingers than heavier gauge strings would be, but it's all relative. Your fingers will adapt to whatever gauge string you use, and if you were using heavier gauge strings and you go back to a lighter gauge string, you'll be bending wildly out of tune and the chords will have poor intonation because you'll be used to thicker gauge strings. So no, thicker gauge strings aren't harder to play, they're just harder to play if you're used to playing lighter gauge strings. And that reminds me, thicker strings don't necessarily mean thicker tone. I mean, yes, Stevie Ray Vaughan used 13 gauge strings and his tone was absolutely iconic, but his tone was iconic because of his fingers, not because of the strings he used. Myth number nine, true bypass equals better tone. True bypass pedals actually suck a tiny little bit of your guitar signal out. True bypass also infers an added buffering function in the pedal, which would then subsequently boost the signal back to where it's supposed to be. But that technically wouldn't be a true bypass pedal then, would it? But honestly, can we even tell the difference in our tone? No. 99% of us won't even notice, and 1% of us will claim that we do. The final myth, and perhaps the most controversial one of this entire list, I'm not gonna make some friends on this one. Myth number 10, the wood a guitar is made from doesn't affect the tone. Ah yes, the tone wood debate. I'm sure you've heard of this subject and the uproar it's caused in our lovely little guitar community to this day. Yes, the wood a guitar is made from absolutely 100% affects the way a guitar sounds. This is especially obvious in acoustic guitars, but it applies to electric guitars as well. If it didn't, then why would a guitarist prefer a mahogany body or an alder body or a rosewood neck or a maple neck? Those who don't believe the wood a guitar is made from affects the tone claim that the pickups, the magnetic pickups in the electric guitar are doing all the work and the wood is just there to, I don't know, look neat. Here's the thing, the strings may not physically touch the wood, but the energy from a strummed string goes through the bridge up the neck into the nut. Those frequencies move through the different types of wood. The fact of the matter is, if somebody says that the wood doesn't affect guitar tone, they probably don't have enough credibility to even make that claim. But hey, who says I have any credibility to make the claim that wood does affect guitar tone? If only there was some undeniable source with the utmost credibility who could settle this for us, somebody who has built one of the most iconic guitar brands in the world, who has created a guitar from any type of wood you could possibly imagine. If only we had someone to set the record straight on tone wood for us. Wait, I know just the guy.
I have read on the internet that people have said there are no such thing as tone woods.
All right. I have a 20,000 watt PA here. What bullshit. All right, so let me explain this. If that's true, and I'm a Cremona violin maker, if I make it out of balsa wood, it won't make any difference, right? I mean, come on. No matter what mic you put on Barbara Streisand, she's not going to sound like Paul Rogers. That isn't going to happen. Right? No matter what mic you put on Frank Sinatra, it's not going to sound like Barbara Streisand. It isn't going to happen. The idea that tone woods don't make any difference is just a bunch of, it's just a load of crap.
Because Frank Sinatra's dead.
So is Stradivari, but you want one of his violins.
So there you have it, guys. 10 guitar myths dispelled. Do you agree with me? No? Well, leave your comments down below. I'd love to hear from you, honestly. I mean, I'm human, I could be wrong. Well, I hope you enjoyed this maybe controversial video, and I'll be back with another video next time. But until then, keep shredding. I'm gonna go get some candy.